My name is Craig Stevenson. I'm the director of training for the Jungian Psychoanalytic Association of New York, the JPA. I'd first of all like to thank Dr. Jeremy Safran, who can't not be here this morning, thank Dr. Jeremy Safran and the New School for co-sponsoring this conference on PTSD and combat trauma. We also thank this morning the International Association of Analytical Psychology and the Helix Center for their support of this important event. Welcome to those of you who are military veterans. You come today in your many roles as social workers, chaplains, a theater director, journalists, students. There are military veteran students who are joining us today as special guests. To all of you, we acknowledge here your service to the country, and we thank you for joining today in this inquiry and this discussion. Finally, welcome to the many people who are following these lectures by live streaming. Hello to our JPA members who are tuning in from New York State and Connecticut, from California, England, and Australia. And hello to viewers who have written to say that you are watching today from Argentina, Canada, France, the Netherlands, Switzerland, China, and Taiwan, to name only a few. I will now ask Margaret Klenk, who is the president of the JPA, to welcome you and to introduce our first speaker.
I will just add a few other thank yous, including to Craig and Patricia Losa, who put this amazing conference together, who've worked diligently and, you know, endlessly to make it all work so beautifully to have us here. So thank you, Craig and Patricia. I echo our thanks to the International Association of Analytical Psychology for their support with grant and seed money, and to the Helix Foundation for its generous support of this program, and of course to the New School. Two sentences about the JPA. We're a society of Jungian analysts, a part of the International Association of Analytical Psychology around the world. We have two training programs, both which result in becoming a Jungian analyst, one for people who have licenses and one for people who are searching for the New York State license in psychoanalysis. Anybody who's interested in the training, we have an open house at the end of April. There's a flyer over there. We have two forms of outreach. We have a clinic for low-fee, people looking for low-fee, Jungian-oriented, psychoanalytically-oriented psychotherapy with a sliding scale. And we do public programs such as this and other things. So it is my great pleasure to introduce to you Roger Brooke. He's a professor of psychology and director of military psychological service at Duquesne University. He's a licensed clinical psychologist in private practice and in a hospital. Roger is an affiliate member of the Interregional Society of Jungian Analysts. His formative years were in the 1980s in South Africa, where he worked with the victims of violence on both sides of the political conflict of that time. He is the author of Jung and Phenomenology, which is a seminal book in this field. He is the editor of Pathways into the Jungian World and co-editor of A Qualitative Vision for Psychology, An Invitation to the Human Science Approach. His recent essay, An Archetypal Approach to Treating Combat Post-Traumatic Stress Disorder, has appeared in the book Outpatient Treatment of Psychosis, Psychodynamic Approaches to Evidence-Based Practice. Please welcome him.
There I am as a young man. I became a paratrooper to impress my girlfriend. It didn't. This is in honor of the dead. The descent to hell is easy, says Virgil. Death's gate stands open night and day, but to retrace our steps, to climb to the air above, this is our life's work, this is our labor. It was Ramadi 2004. The Apache Geronimo said war is a solemn religious matter. Larry Decker, who's a Sufi and wrote a wonderful book called The Alchemy of Trauma, which is a Jungian alchemical model of treating veterans, works at the VA in Santa Barbara. It's wonderful work. He writes that combat is such a mix of horror and bravery that it can be called mysterious. Such an experience can not only horrify and repel, but also attract and sanctify. Coming face to face with Ares is a numinous experience with all the terror and awe that such a confrontation with the gods of war implies. The initiate will never be the same again. His life's journey or her journey is now set on a different path. Second theme, being in the war zone, is that one's omnipotent and idealized fantasies that belong to innocence shatter when becomes consciously mortal or old overnight. This is an extraordinary photograph. That is Mike McWilliams parachuting under fire into Angola. He's pulling very hard left because there was a river underneath him. He'd put a camera on an auto rewind, which took a photograph every 3 seconds. He had attached it to the reserve parachute of the man behind him, and it got this extraordinary photograph about 150 feet from the ground. He said we could hear the rounds passing through our canopies. We live through events without being fully able to experience and process them. Experience and memory become splintered and discontinuous. We are left with a collage of images without clear sequence and without narrative or emotional coherence. What we call a world is held together in language and time as a cosmos. Language, at least combat, shatters this communal order of human relations, social expectations, and institutions. What combat veterans have is a knowledge that the fabric of this aesthetic and moral order of the world as a cosmos is thinner than those at home ever imagine. The confrontation with evil is another theme that seems to be universal. I once knew a young man who was a medic who came across a village in Angola in which children were playing soccer with a human head. To encounter radical evil is to make one forever different from the trusting normal person who wraps the rightness of the social order around himself snugly like a cloak of safety. It's this moral core of combat trauma, which is why so many veterans say they have lost their souls. I would describe soul as that sustaining foundation of our morality, aesthetics, spirituality, and capacity for intimacy. You might remember these lines of Jung written after World War II. He says, "The sight of evil kindles evil in the soul. The victim is not the only sufferer. Everybody in the vicinity of the crime, including the murderer, suffers with him. Something of the abysmal darkness of the world has broken in on us, poisoning the very air we breathe and befouling the water with the stale, nauseating taste of blood. Another theme is that the body really becomes a kind of body armor, and armor is identity. You see how that soldier and that fighting vehicle sort of mirror each other. Combat experience is embodied in physiology and language. It's driven into the structure of identity. The ideal soldier's body reduces pain to information. Toughness, fitness, and strength mask serious physiological stress reactions. I've often been amazed at how many officers and senior NCOs who've spent their lifetimes in elite units are dead in their 50s through stress-related conditions, from alcoholism to strokes, cardiovascular disease, heart attacks. The combat veteran has difficulty speaking with complexity and nuance because the body has lost the sensibilities that make the subtle differentiations of language possible. There's a very intimate and interesting relationship between language and the body, and that the brutalization of one becomes the brutalization and mirrored in the other. I have to tell you, I think, that about 3 years, I was in an elite unit, and after about 3 years after coming out, I had a dream in which I was lying on my bungalow bed in my PT shorts, and I was looking kind of tanned and fit and like I was at 19, and healthy and strong. And then the scene sort of shifted slightly, and my body became more tanned and more muscular and more strong until I was lying there like a sort of an Arnold Schwarzenegger type figure with my skinny arms in your dreams, Rog. Anyway, that lying there on this bed, but the scene became uncanny, and suddenly fault lines appeared through this sort of porcelain-like body until it shattered like a windscreen into, you know, thousands of pieces, and I woke in absolute terror. Of course, it was looking back, as many of you I'm sure will all really recognize, is that a dream like that is a healing dream, because that sort of body really is a caricature of health, and it's not a body in which one can live a civilian or a long life. It's a time also positively of brotherhood and sisterhood, mastery and leadership. Total self-sacrifice in relation to one's buddies, combined with absolute trust in the same from them. Having accepted death, they become the true warriors and masters of combat. Leadership is recognized with honors and promotions. This is an experience of extraordinary love and devotion and parental care. Our guiding questions. What is the meaning of combat experience and its aftermath in PTSD symptoms? What purpose or psychic function might they serve? Let me say that I would call those questions both Jungian. They're also the questions that the phenomenologist asks. Like, what is this phenomenon? What does it mean? And then Jung, what is the wider cultural and mythic context in which we might address the challenges of combat trauma? We can address these questions through that process of psychological deepening and spiritual maturation, which we call individuation. It implies psychic spaciousness, self-acceptance, greater responsibility for one's conduct, and a meaningful place in the wider community. Each of those descriptive phrases, I think, requires considerable mental work. Psychic spaciousness means having enough room in one's sort of mental space, which requires considerable ability to tolerate psychic pain. Self-acceptance means the integration and owning of one's own shadow and culpability, responsibility. Greater responsibility for one's conduct means not carrying on behaving as though one is a victim of other people's malevolence. And a meaningful place in the wider community for many veterans is an extraordinary accomplishment as the recovery of trust in a civilian world. Some archetypal amplification. These wounds of war were described by Homer over 2,500 years ago. The stories of Achilles and Odysseus are stories of men whose moral character is destroyed by war. Odysseus took 10 years to get home from the wars, by which time he had done drugs, betrayed his friends, behaved like a criminal, and his family didn't recognize him. What we in the Christian tradition call the Old Testament is a story of one trauma after another. If you have an ear for it, you can see it running through the book of Samuel, for example. The warrior King Saul disobeyed God's order to kill every living being of the Amalekites and was rejected by God. It is said that an evil spirit descended on him. He became depressed, anxious, paranoid, and murderous. Twice he tried to murder his loyal servant David. 85 priests who approached King Saul and tried to persuade him of David's loyalty were murdered by Saul, and he nearly murdered his own son Jonathan when he tried to persuade his father of David's loyalty, and he ended up committing suicide. In the Indian epic, the Mahabharata, it describes the tragic story of Jayadratha from the war of about 5,000 years ago, in which his loss of moral bearings causes his rejection by the gods and his subsequent self-destruction. The Xhosa of South Africa called it the Kaneni, which is the warrior's insight into the depth and burden that he carries. Sipho Mbukwe said, "It follows you like a shadow, always reminding you of what you have done." The Zulus of South Africa call it the Ukuhlanya, which derives from the word ukuhlanhlata, which means to wander around without direction and to lose one's bearings. It has both a geographical and a moral or spiritual meaning. The Lakota Sioux called it the Nagi Napayape, which translates as "the spirits have left him," reminding us of the many depersonalized veterans who are numb and say they have lost their souls. It's interesting that we know Sitting Bull as a great warrior. His own self-understanding was that he was primarily a healer for his warriors from the psychological wounds of war. And he said that if his warriors are not made whole, his culture will not survive. The Hopi called it the Tawana, a mind in terror, reminding us or emphasizing the hyper-arousal, hyper-vigilance, and flashbacks of many veterans. My favorite term comes from the Civil War, where it was called soldier's heart, naming correctly that traumatized center of our emotional lives, our morality, aesthetics, and capacity for intimacy. So in sum, the psychological wounds of war are moral and spiritual in their core. They've been addressed as such in all traditional warrior cultures. There's an old Maori warrior. Since PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, was instituted into our psychiatric lexicon in 1980 with the DSM-3, and it certainly has its advantages, but it does have unintended consequences, including the stigma of mental illness, social isolation, and a downward spiral. And a really big one for me is that once you have made the wounds of war a psychiatric condition, then it requires mental health professionals in order to so-called treat, in quotes, this psychiatric condition. So it disempowers the family and the church community and local community and so on, who are unsure what their role might be, given that their returned veteran now suffers from a professional psychiatric condition. It also, of course, leaves the veteran with neither dignity nor direction. So moral pain is at the heart of it, and unless we address the moral issues, we're not going to alleviate it, no matter how much therapy or how many medications we apply. I love this photograph from New York recently. "What a returning soldier needs," says Jonathan Shea, "most when leaving war is not a mental health professional, but a living community to whom his or her experience matters." Do you see in the center of that photograph, there's something almost invisible? There's a little girl in a red dress. I just saw that picture and was absolutely gobsmacked. It's the Iraq version of that scene in Schindler's List with the little girl in the red coat. It's the only color in that film. The knowledge in these pictures cannot be medicated away or simplistically reframed. The challenge of individuation is to find a way to live a life that can embrace this knowledge, which is never far from one's mind. So many veterans just feel enraged when they're given medications for these images. With a clue from Winnicott, we can say that all trauma is lived twice. The first time with a ferocious commitment to mission and team survival, where the price is deep depersonalization. Can I say it again? Siri. Of course, the whole purpose of training is precisely so that you do not experience with the fullness of your humanity what you are trained to live through competently. Said differently, if you were in the war zone and the shit hits the fan, if you started to experience that with the full complex range of your humanity, you would be completely unable to function. So once again, the whole purpose of training is precisely that you do not experience what you competently live through. The second time, therefore, is later, in order to experience for the first time the fullness and human truth of what could not be experienced originally. The second time, which is in memories and flashbacks, I think, of PTSD, so-called, is so that the past may be revisited and become a meaningful history, and that once again might be truly lived. I love these lines from Jung. At the heart of it, he says we should not try to get rid of a neurosis, but rather to experience what it means and what its purpose is. In the heart there, he says, we do not cure it, it cures us. From the illness itself, that is, let's say, from the PTSD itself, we can learn so much for our recovery. And what the medical model flings away as absolutely worthless contains the true gold we would never have found elsewhere. An archetypal perspective drawn from our knowledge of traditional warrior cultures offers both dignity and direction to the veteran. Dignity by understanding one's experience as a human universal and not as a mental illness called PTSD. It also offers direction by understanding one's history as a calling for that deepening of experience, self-understanding, and communal place we call integration. We have some wonderful examples of young warriors who have taken their experience and entered the warrior's path, this pathway of moral and spiritual development through the lifespan. I imagine there were a few of you who recognized the young Khoza, founder of Umkhonto we Sizwe, the spear of the nation, the military wing of the African National Congress. This extraordinary transformation led to him being winning the Nobel Peace Prize and being a figure of transformation and peace. He had enormous moral authority as an old veteran. Here's somebody else. Let me introduce you to another one of my countrymen whom most of you might not know, General Jan Smuts. I saw some faces nodding. General Jan Smuts was in his mid-20s, he was an Afrikaner Boer general fighting the mighty British Empire in the 1900. In the First World War, he was in the inner circle of the Allied forces in Britain. Between World War I and World War II, he was, I think, the only person ever to be the Chancellor of both Oxford and Cambridge universities. And he was in Churchill's inner circle during World War II. At the end of World War II, he wrote about his political philosophy of holism. He was involved in the rise of the League of Nations, and then he wrote the preamble to the United Nations, instituted in San Francisco in 1948, I think it was. So he was also an extraordinary transformational figure. the young submariner became President Carter, whose work has, whose foundation has helped promote and democracies around the world. The young infantry officer, Colin Powell, who has enormous moral authority and stature in this country, which was not diminished by his having misled the United Nations. I think that everybody that I know anyway understands that he, or believes that he believed what he was saying. Another one of my favorite soldiers, Israeli Chief of Staff in 1967 during the Six-Day War, Yitzhak Rabin. 1992, he led Israel to the Oslo Peace Accord, for which he won the Nobel Peace Prize. And I at least wonder or think that the Middle East might look very different if he hadn't been assassinated in 1995. This is an extraordinary story of a man. This was a young Australian who was in the Australian SAS, the Special Forces in Vietnam, who became head of the Australian military, General Cosgrove. He led the peace initiatives and the end brought to an end the civil war in East Timor, and he was honored by being made Chancellor of the Catholic University of Australia for his contributions to peace. Some of you might know that St. Francis of Assisi was a veteran of two tours and a POW. He was a POW in his first tour, and when he got home, he didn't fit in. He didn't trust civilians. He felt out of sorts. He didn't get on with his family. And so, like a dumb idiot, he re-enlisted. And during his second tour, he had a breakdown. And fortunately, they didn't have psychiatric buckets of medications to dope him. So his breakdown was a spiritual transformation that gave rise to the Franciscan order. Even in the early years of St. Francis, there was a story, a legend arose that there was a wolf eating people in the hills, and a posse was sent off to kill the wolf. St. Francis said, no, don't do that. I can tame the wolf, which he did. If you think of the wolf in European mythology as a placeholder for everything that is malevolent, lethal, and inhuman, the wolf then, I would say, is what our Vietnam veterans called meeting the beast. And I like to think that St. Francis was able to tame the wolf, not because just because of his relationship to God, but because he was a badass veteran. Of course, you do not need to be a spiritual soldier, a literal soldier in uniform, to be on the warrior's path. We might think of Mahatma Gandhi, whose non-violent action brought an end to the British Empire in India. He had a significant influence on Oliver Tambo and Nelson Mandela, as well as on Martin Luther King. There he is. Freedom is never voluntarily given by the oppressor. It must be demanded by the oppressed. He's one of the great warriors, American warriors of the 20th century, with enormous moral authority. Perhaps the world's most famous warrior right now, Malala Yousafzai. I don't know how to pronounce that. I apologize. Yousafzai. Who was shot in the head by the Taliban for wanting an education, and she is now fighting that good fight. This is an extraordinary scene I want to play you. It is taken during the Occupy Wall Street movement. There are some veterans who take offense to this because they say this is not sort of good decorum for a soldier. It certainly is not parade ground decorum. Other people have taken offense because they think that it's sort of too politicized. So let me say, I'm not showing this as parade ground decorum, and I'm not wanting to make a political statement here. Outside of this, all I want this to show is the extraordinary moral authority of the combat veteran in suppressing violence. During the Occupy movement, there was a moment where some police started beating up some of the protesters, and Sergeant Thomas arrived. Let's hope this works.
Have a good night, guys. They don't lie.
Let's go.
They don't lie. They don't lie. They don't lie, tough guy.
It's not a war zone. This is not a war zone. These are unarmed people. It doesn't make you tough to hurt these people. It doesn't make you tough to hurt these people. It doesn't. I don't care. I don't care about these people. I put in my work. It doesn't lie. It does not make you tough to hurt these people. There's nothing tough about it. Nothing. If you want to go fight, go to Iraq and Afghanistan. But you want to be here hurting U.S. citizens. Where is that in the contract? Where is that in the contract? Leave these people alone.
I imagine that the fact that this is a black man shouting at a lot of white police officers is not going unnoticed.
They're U.S. citizens! U.S. citizens! U.S. citizens! U.S.! It does not make you want to do this to them! It doesn't! Stop hurting these people, man! Why y'all do this to our people? I've been to Iraq 14 months for my people! You come over here and hurt them! They don't have guns! They don't have guns! They don't! Why are you hurting these people? It doesn't make any sense! It doesn't make any sense! How do you sleep at night? There is no honor in this! There is no honor in this! There is no honor in this, man! There's no honor in this shit! There is no honor in this shit! There is no honor in what you're doing to these people! No honor!
I tell you, when you're 18 or 19 or 20 years old and you have a sergeant like that, you'll face the gates of hell. It's very interesting that in traditional warrior cultures, when we look at their healing rituals, we find identical themes from the Plains Indians to the Zulus and Xhosa of South Africa to the Maoris to the ancient Celts, which really suggests that this experience of war and the processes of homecoming or the requirements of homecoming are archetypal, or as we would say, they are universal human experiences and needs. And I would say that our own treatments of combat veterans for the wounds of war are only going to be effective to the extent that they meet these archetypal needs. And I will say positively that a lot of this is going on. Just think of all the films that are made and the documentaries and the storytelling that is done by embedded journalists. The Celts, you know, used to send off their bards to war who would write epic poems and bring them home, and now we have photographic journalists doing the same. For instance, we have isolation and tending. You can't just go straight home. It's absolutely tragic. When the 101st Airborne Division went off to Afghanistan in 2002 and did a tour, when they came home, they came out of Afghanistan and were just dropped at home immediately. And over the next couple of months, something like, I think it was six soldiers murdered their wives. In tradition, for the Plains Indians used to, the old warriors would keep the young warriors away from the villages for, I think it was 19 days before allowing them to come home. And there would be a series of rituals where the old fellows would mentor the young fellows and let the sort of the bloods, the sort of the rage and adrenaline of war settle down. It's a time of making peace with the dead. It's a time of storytelling to the civilian community, either in speech or dance or painting. It's a time of grief and mourning, owning the shadow, and also of being of continued service to one's community, sharing the lessons learned and the wisdom. So many veterans, of course, join the police or the first responders, medics, paramedics, etc. For the last several years, I've taken a group of veterans down the Grand Canyon on the Colorado River, where we did nearly 200 miles on the river over the course of a week. And we started by on the first evening, I invited everybody to bring something which meant something to them, like a little memorabilia or something like that, to introduce themselves. And so I found a nice flat rock. And then everybody would put down their little item and say, look, these are my dog tags, or this is a newspaper cutting about an incident in which my friend was killed. Somebody had put a staff that he had carved in a meaningful way. There was a little American flag, and so on. On that first evening, I introduced the week by saying something like that all of us here have brought with us in our memories and in our imaginations those who haven't come home. We've also brought with us the memories in our memories and imaginations we have brought here with us, memories of civilians and interpreters and the enemy dead who have stayed with us as well. So as we gather here, we don't yet know each other, but what we do know is that this is holy ground, that this is a place where the dead are gathered. And with that, I'd like us to introduce ourselves. And it was an extraordinary moment where people would bring something and in quite a solemn way would just introduce themselves with a very short sort of 30-second story about what their particular item meant. And it gave a certain sobriety and seriousness to the week, even though we also had a heck of a lot of fun, as you can imagine, on the river. When I was in the Kruger National Park in 2013, I mentioned to a young Shangaan guide, the Shangaan is a sort of a cousin tribe to the Zulus, but they're north of the Zulus, up in the eastern sides of South Africa and in Mozambique. It's the Shangaan area. So I asked this young Shangaan man, I told him of my interest, and he said that when a Shangaan man kills another man, whether it's in murder or in battle, or it doesn't make any difference, what he has to do is to build a hut on the edge of the village in that man's name. And then he has to clean it and look after it so that that man's spirit has somewhere to live. Now here's the thing. He then said that when his daughter, if he has a daughter, when his daughter gets to marrying age, she is married to the spirit of the dead enemy. And that she has to look after that hut. And it is only when, if she then falls in love and wishes to get married and live her own life, then her father needs to pray to the dead enemy, perhaps with help from other villagers and with her, and ask the dead to release her so that she can live her life. And then he jumped up and with a great big grin, he said, I must go. And he went off to one of his safari trucks full of happy people wanting to go off and look for wildlife. And he was gone. But I was just stunned at the psychological truth of this as I think of all those daughters whose fathers are veterans, preoccupied, remote, distant, uncommunicative. The fathers are preoccupied with the dead, and the daughters are preoccupied with their fathers, trying to help them, wondering why their fathers seem so disengaged. And we can see that psychologically they too are married to the dead. We had a nursing student, come to the clinic a couple of years ago saying that she wanted to study nursing so that she could work with veterans. And she mentioned that her father was a veteran and she was really, then it turned out that she was really worried about her father and who was drinking and suffering from PTSD. And so we managed to talk to her enough so she invited her father to join us in the next session. So her father then came to the next session with her and we told them this story. And you can imagine the power it had. He immediately just, you know, he told the story and they kind of embraced and he immediately stopped drinking and went to AA and the marriage got repaired. We then saw them individually for a while, but it was quite transformative, the power of this using this story to interpret what was happening between them. American military culture trains people to dehumanize the enemy, and I'm not quite sure why. There seems to be an idea that if you don't dehumanize them, you won't be able to do your job, and I simply don't believe it. Carl Melantes was a Marine officer in Vietnam who suffered from PTSD for many years and has written a wonderful book called What It Is Like to Go to War. The shortcut is that he was interviewed for an hour by Bill Moyers, so you can find him on YouTube if you like. He actually was treated and helped in a transformational way by Larry Decker, whom I mentioned earlier in Santa Barbara. Carl Melantes thinks that this dehumanization of the enemy is profoundly mistaken, and he recommends that sergeants on patrol at the end of any contact with the enemy, that evening when getting together, he should pull the squad together and they should say a prayer in which they pray, this is his prayer, they should pray for the dead and with a sense of real humility and forgiveness about for themselves and for the dead. We are only human. Storytelling is a human universal. I think many of you will remember the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which was started by Archbishop Desmond Tutu and Alex Borain in the mid and late 1990s after the end of apartheid in South Africa. What folks might not know is that this Truth and Reconciliation came out of the local African traditions for the Xhosa. They call it the ukubula, this process of telling the community what happened, where the community has to tolerate the pain of listening and thereby take responsibility for the violence that is done in its name. There's an extraordinary moment where Bishop Tutu just breaks down and starts weeping copiously. And people tried to protect him and asked if he would like to take a break from the hearings, and switch off the cameras. And he said, "No. This is our burden. This is our responsibility. We must tolerate this. This should not be the burden of the perpetrators alone. We are all responsible for this." I think of how different that attitude is from our attitude where Sergeant Bale a few years ago, who walked off into a village in Afghanistan one night and murdered about 20 people in what was almost certainly a completely dissociated, almost fugue-like state, who's now, I think, he's serving life in prison. I think that that's just a double tragedy. That's our responsibility, not his. I think here this process of storytelling to the civilian community as part of the archetypal structure of healing and homecoming really deepens our understanding of what we, in a rather trivial way, call counseling or psychotherapy, where veterans talk to civilian psychotherapists. So many veterans are just astonished to find that there really are civilians. Hey, you veterans out here, I'm talking to you too. So many veterans are just astonished to find that there are civilians who really, really get it, and they do want to know, and they will go with you all the way into those dark places. It's a profound process of homecoming. I do not subscribe to the vomit theory of therapy about getting it out. I think that just is fatuous. I think that what happens is that we have a collage of images and impressions that are quite incoherent or in pieces. But once we speak, especially to a civilian, in our mother tongue, the language of our community, and we start to say, this was frightening, and this was funny, and that was courageous, and I'm so sad about this person, and this leaves me feeling ashamed, and so on and so on, I am, in an absolutely immediate and concrete way, stitching the world as a world of language and aesthetics and values. I'm stitching it together within my community and as a place for my experience to go. So that process of language, especially in relation to a civilian community, perhaps through therapy, is this process of stitching a world together and of homecoming. I found myself, another process that I'd like to talk about is grief and mourning. Here's a phenomenology of grief. To ask, what is grief? By the way, those of us, those folks here who were at my talk last night on phenomenology, we talk about how the psychological phenomena are just our modes of being in the world. If we start off with the question of, is grief a feeling, or is it a set of cognitive processes, or is it a etc., etc., we just get stuck and we start in the wrong place. We should put all that aside and just drop into the phenomenon itself. And note that grief is a universal, and what does it mean and what does it open up for us in terms of our being in the world? Well, I would say that grief is the most original way of remembering the dead. Remembering the dead in grief is a way of honoring them, and as the years go by, of honoring our ancestors. Grief stabilizes our lives, reminding us that we do not make up ourselves anew each day, but that we belong to a story that is older and larger than ourselves. Grief draws us into these wider narratives in which our personal history is not something that belongs to us, but rather we belong to it as heirs with an inheritance to be carried to the next generation. The images which stay with us of the dead at their best are a mirror to the values that we hold most dear. Remembering them at their best reaffirms our guiding values. So if you say you like her friendship, and for you it was loyalty, and for you it was courage, each of those terms, friendship, loyalty, and courage, certainly say something about the deceased. But they're also mirrors to our own guiding values and deepen them and a commitment to them. By honoring them in our grief, we become better people dedicated to a future that might be worthy of their continued presence in our dreams and memories. I remember working with a young ranger once who was drinking and fighting himself into oblivion. And then he went to the funeral of a dead buddy where his 21-year-old fiancée was standing at the graveside and his family. And I asked him what it meant to him to be there when he got home. What did it mean to him to be there? And he said, Doc, I decided I owe it to him to get my stuff together. And with that, he just turned a page. He just stopped drinking. Within a week or two, he had done his homework and had found courses in nursing. He decided he'd like to train to be a nurse, and he studied nursing. He said, I want him, when I think of him, when he comes to mind, I want him to be proud of me. You might remember that at the end of that film, Saving Private Ryan, as well, when Private Ryan, the old man, is looking across the cemetery, and he hopes that the dead will think that he lived a good life. We do not reach closure, that silly term of pop culture. What we can achieve is a way of living with dignity, recognizing the preciousness of the living to whom we remain indebted. Anniversaries and memorial rituals are occasions of continued self and communal renewal. Grief also brings the world closer. Unlike depression, which pushes it away. Of course, depression can mask grief. We might push it away precisely because the intimacy of grief would be overwhelming. Simple acts of kindness or a dog's friendly approach mean so much to us in grief. It is very difficult to be unkind in grief, although it's easy when we're depressed. We are made tender in grief and intimate with the world. This intimacy in grief is also a kind of erotics. It connects the vulnerable, open-hearted flesh of the human body and the flesh of the world in an ecology of intimacy and care. I think I'll just say one of these stories and then I'm going to stop. I'm going to go through, tomorrow morning, I'm going to mention a number of different clinical vignettes and talk about how we can work this material into clinical practice. But let me just touch on this very short one. There was a young soldier, a sergeant, who was absolutely tormented by nightmares, and he had been for a number of years. The nightmares were not only nightly, but when he woke in terror in the heart of this nightmare, he would go back to sleep knowing it was going to happen again. He said, "Doc, I was a good soldier. I was trained to take out targets. And when I was in Iraq, I kicked down doors and I took out the targets. And in my nightmares, it's the same thing. I'm kicking down doors and I'm taking out the targets." And then his chin started to quiver. And he said, "Doc, but in my nightmares, the targets have faces. And they know it's the last second of their lives." I said to him that I thought I could help him, but it might be really difficult for him, but I thought I might be able to help him if he liked. And he said, "Yes, please." So I said, "Well, since you know you're going to have this nightmare tonight anyway, I suggest that when you go to bed is to let the nightmare come to you while you're awake. And at the point where you wake up, or normally wake up, see if you can just stay with it and settle down until you can kind of just see it. And when you're ready and are calm enough, ask the dream, 'What is it that you want of me that you keep returning, claiming my attention night after night?'" He came to our group in the morning and he said, "I did what the doc said, and I think these nightmares want me to be human again." And we then talked about how he recovers his own humanity by recognizing the humanity of the dead and honoring the dead. A 1-year follow-up and a 2-year follow-up, the nightmare had never recurred. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your presentation.
My father.
I'm a Army chaplain, presently serving. And my friend Pia reminded me of a story from Carl Marlantis's book, where he talks about the mass that his Franciscan, or the friar, a priest friend of his, they constructed a very late night mass in order to do exactly what you were just saying about honoring the dead. And he said that they went through the ritual of blessing the space with holy water and incense, and then opened wide the door. And Carl talks about how he could feel the souls of the dead fill the chapel. And on one side were the enemy dead, and on the other were the friendly dead. And that about midway through the service, he asked the priest to please stop, and he said, "Why?" And he said, "All of them are crossing the aisle."
Wow.
And they're embracing one another. And they just let that happen for a few minutes, and then everybody went back to where they were seated, and he said, "Please continue." And so the image there of reconciliation, even among those who have fallen, as a very powerful one, and I think it's another illustration of everything that you're saying, which is so very potent, about the nature of war, what it really does to the human person, mm-hmm. and how people are trained to go into that. And I believe you're exactly right that the theory is that if you depersonalize the enemy, then you'll be able to more effectively kill them, which is
just not true.
Not true. So I just wanted to offer
Thank you.
That.
Yes. There's a wonderful story. My father was a frontline infantry officer in World War II, and he fought in Italy, all the way up the spine of Italy, until he was shot and captured one night late in 1944. A book was written on the Italian campaign a few years ago, and I read some correspondence that came back from it, and it was really interesting. The author said, "You will be sorry to know," so my father had obviously inquired. He said, "You will be sorry to hear that Lieutenant Reder, who captured you, was shot and killed about a month later. But his commanding officer, Lieutenant Colonel, and I forget the man's name, whom my father met, he came into the room where my father had been shot and captured. But that so-and-so remembers you very well and sends his warm regards and is glad to hear of your that you've had a good life. My commanding officer is probably the most famous or infamous, depending on which unfortunate side you were. Colonel Jan Breitenbach was SAS trained and a South African. He was the founder of, he was my commanding officer in 44 Parachute Brigade. He was the commanding officer at Kasinga, the founder of the Reckies and the founder of 3-2 Battalion. And he was absolute hell on wheels. If he ever seemed to be pleased with your performance, he managed to get over it in a second or two. He was absolutely unrelenting, but he also would do anything for you. He required nothing of you that he wasn't there first. He had heart bypass surgery a few years ago, and when he was recovering at his home, a couple of Angolan senior officers arrived at his front door. And he looked at them and wondered what this was about, and they had a couple of briefcases and looked very smart, and they said, "Colonel Breitenbach, sir, we have been sent by General so-and-so," who at that stage was now the head of the Angolan army, "with warm greetings to an old warrior, an honored old foe and warrior. And he says that if you have any difficulty with your medical expenses in this capitalist country, that he would be honored to pick up the bill." And so it goes.
excuse me. Sorry. Roger, I have a question. The wars that you've been talking about, Iraq, Afghanistan, I guess you mentioned Angola, but particularly for us, I'm thinking Iraq and Afghanistan, were obviously wars in kind of parentheses, I guess. Afghanistan, is it a war? But about which there's a great deal of ambivalence and so on and so forth. And if the essence, as I hear you, what I hear you saying, at the heart of the return home is sort of coming home, is reconnection with community and so on, how is that sort of process affected in the case of wars like Iraq and Vietnam too, I guess, compared to, say, a war about which there was no doubt as a just war, World War II?
Yeah, that's a very good question, and the answer is that there's a significant difference at one level. I mean, the if we do any better now, it really is thanks to the Vietnam veterans who just said, "We can't let this happen again." Jonathan Shea's book, Achilles in Vietnam, discusses in great detail the moral contract between the soldier and the civilian community. The soldier is prepared to, as they say, it's a blank check to Uncle Sam, and it might even include my life. The other side of that moral contract is that will never be abused for trivial purposes or selfish purposes, but only when absolutely necessary. And so so many Vietnam's veterans felt this profound betrayal and this appalling moral pain of being in Vietnam in a war and killing people when they saw themselves as the enemy and as the invading army. There are some Iraq and Afghan veterans who feel similarly conflicted. There was much less conflict in World War II in that regard. And there's no doubt that the whole society and that moral question is terribly important in helping people come home and helping people feel that they at least fought a good and an honorable fight. But it mustn't. I think it also shouldn't be overstated. At the end of World War II, there were more psychiatric referrals than all other referrals combined. So it's not true that our World War II veterans didn't suffer because it was an honorable war. But it has been a question that goes back in history. The notion of an honorable war, I'm sure the father here will confirm this, goes back, I think, to St. Augustine. So the question of what is an honorable war and a just war, etc. So but it's a crucial question, absolutely crucial. Thank you.
Hello. A comment more than a question about this thing that you brought up of experience of grief and the language and the interplay between the two. And as a non-native English speaker in an English-speaking culture, I mean, I really see this thing of, like, you showed all these indigenous cultures and their sort of deep-seated historical experience of dealing with grief and the rituals that are there in place for generations. And then you have people like us who are kind of uprooted from there and who are placed in a culture which does not have that container. And even when we speak our deepest truth, it's in a language that's not ours. And I'm just wondering, like, if you have any words of wisdom around that, or
I wish.
How do you see the future evolving in that way?
I work for an organization called Soldier's Heart. In fact, I was elected president this week. I was elected. It's an organization founded by Ed Tick and Kate Dahlstedt, his wife. They have been working with veterans for a number of years. When Ed Tick started to work with veterans, Sitting Bull visited him in several dreams and said, if you want to work with veterans, you need to learn my people's ways. So he took himself off to the Dakotas back in the 1970s for several summers, and he was trained in Lakota Sioux healing traditions by Sitting Bull's great niece, until she said, now you know, and do it. And he's an authority on warrior cultures around the world and through history, particularly the Greeks as well. And he has developed a series of retreats, sort of a four-day retreat program, which takes these themes of homecoming. And these retreats are quite large, usually a couple of dozen people, and a mixture, that's always a mixture of veterans and civilians, and veterans from different eras too. And we've developed a way of trying to ritually work this material. He was contracted, I was wondering whether the chaplains knew him, because he was contracted in 2012 to provide training for all 1,200 chaplains in the army, and he provided training for senior officers in NATO. There are now several Veterans Administration hospitals that have taken up the model of Soldier's Heart, which is the model I've described today. This is sort of the conceptual background to the model. So we are working in various ways in the culture. I've done presentations similar to this at many veterans administrations. I'm training doctoral students in this. I bring this model into the work in the Grand Canyon. So it's small, but we do try to find, at least so that veterans who are open to it can find this kind of sanctuary and place of ritual healing. I think we should, is it time?
Thank you very much. Would you say something about those who are called conscientious objectors and their interactions with veterans and what you think about in terms of your model working with that? And anything you can say about working with the children who are surviving their parents?
Yeah, two quick comments. I have enormous respect for a conscientious objector. In South Africa, if you were a young 18-year-old white boy being sent off to the army and decided to be a conscientious objector instead, you went to prison for 6 years, unless you were a Jehovah's Witness, and then they had other things you could do. But you can pay a high price, and it's often a lonely position. So I have enormous respect for conscientious objectors. As I said, there are different ways to be a warrior. One does not have to be in uniform. The children, there's a lot of research on the children of veterans away in these recent wars, and they really struggle. What I would like to suggest is that one should talk to one's kids in a fairly supportive but realistic way. Don't be facile to them. So when the children know that, say, dad or mom is in Iraq and they're scared, then you can say, look, you say, yes, I can see we're all a little bit worried. We're all a bit worried about him, you know, but there are an awful lot of people there. It is true that there have been some people who've been injured and hurt, and yes, it is true that some have been killed. But there are an awful lot of people there too, and we only hear those ones. Nearly all of them come home and are okay and so on, and it's like when you hear of somebody killed in a car crash, we don't immediately imagine that anybody in a car is going to die. So you do try to be realistic and just settle it down. But to say things like, well, daddy's big and strong and so nobody can hurt him, I mean, the child knows you're just lying. So it's much better to be, I think, sort of both supportive and encouraging, but also fairly, you know, realistic in a way. When we're children, we're not stupid. And it really helps kids if you bring them into therapy, or if you can have little play groups, or you help them draw their experience. All those sort of therapeutic techniques and so on work wonderfully with kids, and can do it in school and classrooms. You know, in some of those classrooms near military bases where so many of the parents are away, for example, you can do artwork in class and so on, which could be really helpful without calling it therapy or something that becomes sort of problematic. Thank you so much.